fooling with us. With one of the barbers one night in the kitchen sink, I took the mechanism out of it. I took a razor knife and cut it in half on the red and white line. Took a cigarette and I burned an indentation into the top half of the red half. And I took that weight that was down on the bottom, put it in the top, put it back together, put a little glue in it and glued it back together, and that's what I come up with. Mm-hmm. That gave me a top-heavy barber that would tell me when I'm too shallow.
Well, when the guys were telling me about, you know, how you rig up for a float and fly, you know, they said, you know, go buy Bob's bobber and it's weighted and all this. And then, of course, after I bought them, I got home, I started thinking about it. I said, how this sucker going to turn over on his side if it's weighted? So, you know, I got my little fly, my little 3 inches of line, went to the kitchen sink, you know, and filled it up. Sure enough, it worked.
That's, we've all played good.
You know, it will turn over.
Bob, show us that trick again on the... how to measure your leader.
Well, like I said, I've got two wrong halves of rod. They won't go together, but put your rod together and you measure from the stem of the reel, which is right here, to the tip. All right? And then measure from the stem to the first guide and to the second guide and to the third guide. And on these all-pro rods, it turns out to be 10 foot to the first, 11 foot to the second, 12 foot to the third. That gives me a way of measuring leader real quick without having to tape measure and all that.
All right.
Good idea.
Now, was this originally a crappie method?
It was. That's how it got started.
Who started it?
Charlie Knuckles, East Tennessee.
When is floating fly fishing the best?
When the water temperature hits 50 degrees or less.
What about the clarity of the water? Do we have to wait till the lake turns over?
We've been catching a few, and the lake hadn't turned over yet. Generally, it gets really good after turnover, and it clears up. That's when it starts getting real consistent. Okay. Now it's just kind of hit and miss.
Yeah. I was thinking, it seemed like the clearer it is, the better that...
Well, that ain't necessarily so. If you're fishing water that ain't real clear, like Dale Hollow, let's say you went to Kentucky Lake or Rough River or someplace where you don't have quite the water clarity, then you want to use a brighter jig, because the first thing they have to do is see it before they can hit it. Now here, right here is my favorite. This is tied from duck feathers. This, in Dale Hollow, this jig looks more like a little thread fin shad than anything I've ever thrown.
I got several of those.
But if I were going someplace where the water wasn't as clear, then I'd want a crap carrier jig with a little yellow or a little chartreuse or something more visible.
Howdy, Thomas. This is Thomas Weaver, manager of Horse Creek. How you doing, Bob? It's all right.
He catches fish and lets the other guy out and hold him.
Thomas,
I'm here.
Okay, good deal. Glad you made it. Talked to him for about, 15 minutes trying to get him here?
About 20 miles on the car between here.
I've been asked 1,000 times, why can't you use a slip mopper? And I know damn well everybody that ain't got a floating fly rod is looking to do this with an existing rod. And it won't work with a slip mopper. First of all, that jig ain't heavy enough to pull a line down through a slip bobber.
Well, to be honest with you, the first time I heard about floating fly and how you set it up, you know, and I thought years ago, well, just use a slip bobber.
Right. Yeah. How are you? Right there's the reason, 16 pounds.
I figured it out.
And if you put more weight on it and get it to slide through a slip bobber, when you start working it back towards the boat, you lose your depth control because that thing will climb right back up to the bobber. Yeah. Because there's more to it than throw it out there and sitting and watching it. You're working it the whole time. Okay. So you have to have a fixed bobber.
I was going to ask you about the color pattern. You mentioned that this is the type of water you've got down here. This is the preferred color.
Yeah, that's subtle. It's kind of a subtle gray.
Because I know when you go to buy the jigs, there's rainbow assortment.
Well, those rainbow assortments, like with chartreuse in them, yellow in them, blue in them, pink, those work really good on colored water because they're more visible.
So most of my fishing pretty much comes up in like marker, mainstays. No, nothing like this.
Well, if you don't go to the park, you go through the cut through. All right, canal. Turn left and start fishing. Land between the lakes, Kentucky Lake. The side next to land between the lakes where all the smallmouth are. Go up about Pisgah Bay and fish your way south. Because that's where the channel, if you'll go right up there on a boat and take a look at it, that's where the channel buoys are closest to the shore. Okay, go through the canal into Kentucky Lake.
Oh, into Kentucky?
Yep. Turn left and look at the buoy lines. The buoy lines are closest to the shoreline.
Right.
Along between Pisgah Bay and 68 Highway Bridge. Those smallmouth hang out in that deeper water.
You want that spade on again?
From Pisgah Bay to 68 Bridge, we're going to fish the smallmouth.
What kind of banks do you like to fish the floating fly on, Bob?
I like the deeper, steeper stuff, 45-degree banks. And I'll fish mainly off the main lake.
Okay. Not a lot of the creeks other than the ones up on the
upper end. Shad make a migration in the wintertime to the creeks.
Okay.
You'll catch fish on the main lake, but they'll be small ones.
Okay.
The heavier fish go back in the creeks.
Okay. All right.
So you fish the creeks near the mountains?
We got three out here today and then we got outside the docks. We started, about 50 yards before you get to the idle buoys and fished about...
Actually, probably 100 yards from the buoy. Yep.
And then probably fished 400 or 500 yards past the buoy.
Yeah. And the fishing was pretty good. I mean, you know, for 2 hours, three fish, that's, you know.
We had three and a break off.
Yeah. I had a nice one break off. I'd like to see that one.
You mentioned the leader, length of 10 feet, 12 feet, something like that. And I just looked at my reef, I seen this creek just go off. Is there some magic about that? Why you want 10 feet or... I just think some of the fish are there.
Well,
a lot of big fish and never catching fish.
These
20, 30 feet. Yeah.
Well, let me explain one to you. We have two schools of minnow. We got the thread gun shad that stay shot 15 feet or so. When we got the mail flies, we came from Lake Michigan on a deep, cold, loving creek. This was 25, 30 foot deep. So you got one bunch of smallmouth that are targeting those at 25, 30 foot deep, and then you got others that are targeting the shallow. What we're after with the flies are the ones that are targeting the shallow. Because I ain't run into anybody yet that can throw a 25 foot leader on one. It helps. If I was going on a lake I'd never fished before, I'd spend the first 30 minutes looking at the depth and trying to locate, see how deep the depth, how deep the bait fish are holding.
So you're trying to keep that jig right near the bottom?
No.
Up?
No, we're keeping that jig in whatever depth. Today we fished at 12 foot deep. We were longer this spot because those fish are suspended. That's the key to wintertime smallmouth fish. They will suspend.
We don't care.
You're just out there. It's out there in the middle.
Peter, they're just about dormant. Colder the water gets, the slower the metabolism gets. Everybody knows that. Hardly anybody stops to think that bait fish metabolism is equally slow. Nothing in that 50-degree water moves very fast. Everything's just like slow motion. That's why if you threw a jerk bait, spinner bait, crank bait, they'll ignore it because it looks unnatural in that environment. Because nothing is moving fast. Everything's moving real slow. And they won't chase anything. You can throw a crank bait by them, they just look at it. Unless it just comes right right close to it. And this thing, we can control that speed and that depth with that bottle. That's why it's so effective.
Never had it explained like that. Visualizing everything just moving real slow.
Oh, yeah, everything.
You always hear it, especially slow, but never thought about everything moving slow.
Yeah, not only the metabolism of the predator fish and the bait fish, that they're slow too, very slow. They don't move very fast at all. And they'll ignore anything that moves fast. They won't exert any energy to chase anything. But you can dangle this little old jig right in front of their faces and they just take it. The only other way to catch them like that when they're suspended is with a jerk bait. But they'll only hit the jerk bait when it's stopped. Okay? So you take your typical cast with a jerk bait, crank it down, jerk it, stop it, jerk it, stop it. It's only stopped four or five times on a typical cast. So you only got four or five chances to get hit, because they won't hit it when it's moving. With this, it's virtually stopped all the time.
He's got a new blonde wife.
It ain't moving.
There you go.
Just wiggling
one. Yeah.
And it ain't trying to get away from
them. Obviously, I suppose the hookup rig is a lot. Gets a lot more fish like this, because that's what you're doing.
Yeah, because you're controlling the speed and the depth. Back when I was a kid, there was one of the old fishermen that wrote a lot of articles. The guy did a lot of fishing with spoon plugs.
Perry?
Perry?
Something was Perry.
Anyway.
Last name was Perry, I think. Or
his whole theory was if you can control the speed and the depth, you can catch fish. And he made these spoon plugs in different sizes that dive different depths. And that was about the depth of the trip.
Yeah.
Well, he was absolutely right. If you control the speed and the depth, you'll catch fish. And you can't control it no better than you can with that.
Now, sometimes you dress that fly. Sometimes you don't. What's the reason?
I dress it all the time.
What
did I do with that jig?
Right
there.
Steal that.
Steal the jig?
Punisher makes a product they call fish dope.
No.
It's basically petroleum jelly, beeswax, with a little bit of scent in it. I just happen to have some that ain't in their container, but it's the same stuff. Now you see the shape of that? I'm going to make it look like a minnow.
Did you shoot or he shoot? He shot.
And that's what I use it for.
Hold that out a little bit, Bob, so I can get a... All right. There you go. Looks just like a minnow.
Before you put the dressing on it, it just looked like a gob of feathers. Right.
Pull that. This side. He's pulling up. He's picking up. He'll make it.
Actually, pull the other door, but that's all right. Doesn't matter.
All right. Punisher likes to
if you break it, Thomas is standing there watching. Practice. So
doesn't matter because of the garlic the smell. To it.
Okay.
I don't really know.
Come on in.
Like
would y'all like some burgers? Got deer burgers and I got hot dogs.
And then the other thing is maybe they don't like garlic.
Soft drinks and coffee too.
I think they like the smell of that. Okay. They do
coffee over there.
And that covers up the humans then. That's mainly the reason I use it.
Oh, maybe 20 pounds. We've been got to go through that.
I drank too. I put a little of that chocolate in that coffee. It's pretty good.
God, the last time you did, you put vanilla.
Well, no, I bought vanilla coffee. I thought the guys would like it. I didn't do that this time.
I didn't think I could taste that. Well, knowing you, you probably did.